Without further ado, it's time to welcome to the stage. We first met her in Harry Potter, the Order of the Phoenix, as a quirky quality Ravenclaw, Luna Lovegood. Her real life Harry Potter knowledge can rival anyone in this room. Please help me welcome Evanna Lynch. Dumbledore's Army and Ravenclaw's Seeker. Our next guest is an actress who portrayed Cho Chang. Please help me welcome Katie Lee Young! Now, Neville Longbottom started his journey as a shy and clumsy and finished as a courageous hero. Please help me welcome Matthew Lewis! Now, she was the youngest of the Weasleys and the true love of Harry Potter. Please help me welcome the actress who portrayed Ginny Weasley, Bonnie Wright! Like that music. Now, our final guest portrayed one of Harry Potter's best friends. As Ron Weasley, he stood by Harry's side from the very beginning. Please help me welcome Rupert Grint! Final night. That's all for you. All right. Here's what we're going to do right now, all right? We have our four question takers out there. They're going to be out there. You want to get their attention. They're going to be the ones that are going to be fielding the questions out there for you to ask to our esteemed panel up here. Here's what's gonna happen. We're gonna go in order, get their attention. We're gonna go down, ask your questions. We're gonna start with Julia right there.
I've got Cammy with me from Germany with a question for Matthew.
Yeah, hi. So I saw in Instagram a photo from you that you said that your mom's helping you get autographs. And I was wondering how this is working. So is she like looking at the autographs and saying this stuff looks good, you know, and lets you do it again?
Yeah, I for anyone who doesn't know, a bit of background, I Instagrammed a picture of my mother, and she was furious. I had to delete it. But the thing is that my mom helps out with a lot of my my fan mail and gets it all ready for me to come in and sign. But she's constantly just over my shoulder the entire time. And when I sign it, and she hates my handwriting and thinks that I don't, you know, I'm not doing it properly. And so when I'm not looking, she'll tidy up all my signatures and go over them again to make them look more like my own signature. I don't know why she does that. But anyway, I caught her doing it and I put the picture on and yeah, she was so mad. I was in so much, my dad called me and I was in so much trouble. But that's how it works. Yeah, she goes over it with a pen. I've told her not to do it. But you're technically getting two signatures for the price of one, so.
It keeps in the family, that's good. All right, Aaron, what do you got out there?
Guys, I have Olivia here. She has a question for Rupert. She's been waiting 2 days very patiently to ask.
First off, I love you.
Thank you.
And my question was, because I'm an aspiring Broadway actress, and I was wondering, what are your favorite parts or perks of working on Broadway versus on film?
Nice. How's everyone? How you doing? Okay, yeah, good question, yeah. I love doing something. I've only done it twice now, but something I always wanted to do. It's very different, it's terrifying. I was having panic attacks nearly every night. It's very scary. But yeah, you get such an amazing feeling. It's such a thrill to be on stage and have such a... an instant kind of reaction. It's incredible. Also, you don't have to watch it back, is another perk I like. But yeah, no, it's great. It's just an incredible feeling, and yeah, I love it. I would love to do it again.
Awesome. Rusty.
I have Meg here from Florida. She's a world traveler. And she has a question for the panel.
Okay, I was just wondering, of the parks that are here in Orlando, from each side, which area do you feel more of a connection with, in Hogsmeade or my home in Diagon Alley?
That's a tough one. I would say I'm from London, but I now live in New York. So for me, the fact that I have a little nostalgia of going home, like the strip in terms of like the King's Cross and the London area, for me is, well, first of all, incredibly surreal seeing like a palm tree in King's Cross in the same image. It's a very bizarre thing. So the most tropical I'll probably ever find my hometown. But yeah, I think it's quite cool seeing a part of London being transported to Florida. And I think the actual journey you go on walking through London and then Diagon Alley is it just really well designed. I think you used to always think that everything in theme parks is on a grand scale, whereas when you walk through that alleyway, you feel like it's a real personal journey just for you. Like you're the only one turning that corner. So yeah, it's nice to have London here.
I would say also Diagon Alley, particularly the Magical Menagerie. I feel like that's just Luna's shop. She would love that place because it has all these amazing creatures that don't look like our animals. And yeah, I like it because it's like a glimpse into a world that we didn't see. Because, you know, every country has their own set of animals and that's part of their culture. And I feel like seeing the insight into the magical, well, the fantastic beasts, I should say, is, it just gives us more of a glimpse of the world. And yeah, I just love that shop. It's really beautiful.
Love you!
Love you!
Brian.
Hey, I've got Larissa from Kentucky, and she's got a great question for Ivana.
Okay. Hi, Ivana. You're my idol, and I love you. So I want to know what the last scene you filmed was for Harry Potter and how you felt the moment they yelled cut.
Last scene, it was nice. The last scene was one of those big ones, because I was afraid it was going to be just like some lousy shot of my hand or something, because that often happens. There's an anticlimax. But the last scene I shot was a big one in the courtyard where it's the face-off with Voldemort and the Death Eaters. I can't remember the exact shot, but it was just one like I didn't feel like there wasn't a lot of pressure on me. I didn't have anything to say, but it just felt it was real. It was definitely the perfect way to end, like with the whole family. And I just felt very numb, to be honest. And also, because people kept talking about the end and how sad it was, and I used to just have so much fun on set that it wasn't till I was leaving, I was changing out of my costume and realizing, oh, it's not mine anymore. You know, what felt like mine, the radishes and the purple, all the purple. It just like, I was releasing it to someone else. I was like, oh damn, it's Warner Brothers, you know? So yeah, that's when I really started crying and broke down and threw a bit of a tantrum in the producer's office. Yeah, just it was a mix of emotions, but I was really happy to be with everyone, like the whole Potter family on the last day.
Rusty.
I have Sierra here, and sorry, Samira, I'm real good with names. And she is from Miami and has a question for you.
This happened to me last year. I'm trying to stay very nervous. The food on set, did it taste the same as the food here, like the butterbeer? Did it taste the same as it does here? I'm already getting an answer from Ivana. So does the butterbeer taste the same in the movie?
We didn't even have butterbeer on set, so that was like this is the first time we got to try it. It was exactly in the same shoes as you guys.
See, they care more about you guys than our.
Yeah.
They're like, we want the fans to love it. You guys are actors, you can pretend.
I remember asking the props guys how they put the foam on the fake butterbeer, and it's much like how you make drinks like whiskey sours or pisco sours. You whip egg whites. And so they use the egg whites, and then they put it on like a really terrible like soda. It tasted horrible. So
you actually had to drink that?
Yeah, we drank it.
Julia.
Yes, I have Tira with me from Orlando.
Hi. Any fun regrets while filming? any fun regrets?
Fun regrets.
It's an oxymoron if I ever heard one.
Yeah.
Possibly eating the food.
Tag on to the last one.
Yeah, I kind of read the last question. Yeah, there was one scene where I had to eat it was just breakfast cereal, but it was called Cheery Owls. So I got really excited and I ate loads of it. And after a while, I was like, this is just Cheerios with nice packaging. Yeah, always eating the food. And that's the thing, once you ate it in the first shot, you had to keep eating it.
For how long? What's the longest you
had? How many takes it took. And with David Yates, always at least 10. Yeah.
I've literally just had a fun regret, not on set, but I just died like a whole pint of butter beer. So I'm on like a massive sugar high right now, which is why I'm not saying anything, because my mind's just like black. Yeah.
Did you go with the frozen butter beer or?
No, just the normal cold one. Maybe someone spiked it. Yeah. Maybe you'll, yeah.
Maybe.
I'm up there somewhere.
She's got butter freeze going on.
Yeah.
All right, Erin.
I have Christina here. She is from Massachusetts with a question for the panel.
Hi, I had a question. My question was, is there anything after Ken had taught you guys, something positive that you can carry on in your careers?
Is there something that Alan Rickman taught
as an actor
that you guys will carry on through your careers?
Some of you might know I have a problem with laughing uncontrollably at inappropriate times, and he did help me with that. He used to always tell me to, I'm not gonna do his voice, but he used to tell me to relax my face, and then I won't laugh, and it kind of worked. Yeah.
Me personally, it's not so much actual piece of advice that he gave. I think a lot of it was the way that he held himself. The professionalism, the charm, the humour. A lot of people can get very worked up about our industry and can get very stressed and worry. And I think one of the things that I learned from Alan and everyone else, actually, I know you tell the story about Helena having a similar thing, is the idea of just have fun. You know, have fun with what you're doing. We're so fortunate to be doing our job, to be doing what we love. And every day you saw Alan, you know, and he put in an incredible performance as Snape, but he was always having fun with it. And that's something that I try and take away, definitely.
I just think as well, pure commitment, like so committed to the role and so took it seriously. And I think there's a distinction between, like, you have to not take yourself seriously as an actor, but take the character seriously. And he just always, of all the people on set, like, I've heard other people say they had conversations with him, but whenever I would, like, in those scary moments I made eye contact, I just felt chilled, you know, like, other people, I think, they will try to smile or try and reach out to you or something, but he was always just so committed to his character, and I just think that shows on screen, and I think it shows he had so much respect for his character, and that's what I like to try and find now. Because then when I met him one time out of character, he was so nice and sweet, and he was just generous personally. And it really made me think how much he goes into his characters, how much of himself he sacrifices for his character.
I remember when he passed away, I was, you know, on the internet reading about kind of all the things that he had said, you know, all his kind of like famous quotes, and one of them, I'm just paraphrasing here, but he mentioned about how, you know, as actors we're kind of tools for making a change in the world, and that I thought was really beautiful, because I think it's true, and it takes you out of yourself and makes you think about, you know, how you can make you know, the world a better place without thinking about, you know, without thinking, overthinking about your acting or anything. If you bring it out of yourself, then it just gets easier.
Yeah, I think obviously for most of us, we were very much, it was our first experience ever acting in Harry Potter. So we were very much almost children playing children in those early movies. And I think it was people like Alan that we had the fortunate experience to be with that really inspired us and shifted our perspective of what we were doing. And what we were doing wasn't just sort of playing kids, but we were actually doing a creative profession. And his charisma was just infectious. Like, you'd step on set and the energy shifted in the room. And I think as young children, I think we're all just so grateful to be able to have the opportunity to look up to someone like that. And it was like our own kind of mini drama school, mini film school, really. And I think he was always really playful. Like, he knew that he could wind us up, and he knew that we were incredibly scared of him sometimes. And I think he took the liberty to, like, wind us up in a positive way. So so I think we're all very sad that he's left us, but luckily we have these movies that he lives on.
Brian.
Hey guys, I have Chelsea from Orlando, Florida, and I'll tell you what, she's been standing in the same spot pretty much since 9 a.m. yesterday to ask this question.
I just was curious if there was a set or a location in all the years that you filmed that you feel the strongest, like, emotion or just happy memory from.
Is there a specific location or set that you feel the most connection to?
I remember being, you know, when you're really young and the half years between the real years are like a big deal. So you don't say you're 10, but you're 10 and a half, and you don't say you're 11, you're like... So I remember working out, obviously my first scene was on platform 9 3/4 in King's Cross. And I remember being really, really, thought it was a really cool idea that I was actually the age of 9 3/4 on platform 9 3/4. So that set obviously was the first experience of any of the Harry Potter world and film set for me. So that will always remain a really strong place for me as a character and person. And I managed to finish the entire series on platform 9 3/4 as the older Ginny Weasley with my family, so yeah.
That was full circle.
It did, it literally came full circle, yeah.
Anybody else?
To be honest, my character was always just wandering along characters, corridors, and so I don't really have a set at a moment on, but a set that I just loved, and kind of sometimes on lunch breaks, and it was only there for a little bit, I would go and have lunch there. It was the Lovegood House, because they had all this beautiful artwork, which I don't think you even really get to appreciate in the film, but they had all the creatures, like a mural around the wall, and they had the dirigible plums, which are what people call the radishes that she wears, but they're actually dirigible plums. And it just was nice. It was like, because I think Luna's, her beliefs and their little world are often dismissed as being fantasy, and this was this little place that where the fantasies were realized and where they were celebrated. So yeah, I loved hanging out at the Lovegood House, but it was quickly knocked down, so it only lasted a few weeks.
It's nice while it lasted. All right, Rusty.
Evan here, Evan from Georgia, and he has a question for him.
What was the craziest thing that ever happened
while you were filming?
Way to narrow that down, Rusty.
Just trying to be specific.
I love that question. The craziest thing that ever happened. Dan hyperventilated in the Great Hall. I don't know what caused that. I think it was when we were all, do you remember that, when we were all clapping?
One of the many.
Yeah. Which, when was it? It's like one of the first, the second film.
Yeah.
We're all clapping at the end.
Oh, right, okay.
Dan hyperventilated.
Why?
I don't know, because he's go over excited.
He gets very excited.
Yeah, he does get excited.
He gets very excited. That's pretty crazy.
Yeah.
I think that fits in the realm. All right, Julia.
Yes, I'm over here. I have Mercedes with me from Pittsburgh.
Hi, I was just letting you know I do have a tattoo on my foot that says follow the spiders just for
Rupert. No way.
Prove it.
No way.
I can't
see.
It's right here.
Right here.
I can't where see. Are you?
Where are you?
Over here.
Oh, I can't see.
Oh, there, yeah, I see.
And so I got it because it means face your fears because you were scared of spiders. So I wanted to know what each one of your guys' fears were and if you've ever conquered them. Oh, and you forgot to do the rap earlier, so.
Oh.
No way.
That would be his biggest fear.
Yeah.
Let's go with the fear first.
I'll definitely do it at the end. I just need to do a bit of a warm up. I will do it. I promise. I'll try to remember. Oh my god! Quickly, somebody answer the questions.
Biggest fear, and have you conquered it?
Mine is actually spiders, and no, I have never conquered that fear. I actually had the hypnotherapy for it in New Zealand. Didn't work. I think I'm even more scared of spiders now. I was once trapped in my kitchen by a spider. And I lived with my mate Nick at the time, and he was on a night out, and I paid for him to come home in a taxi to kill the spider and then a taxi back into his night out because I wanted to go to bed and I couldn't get out of the kitchen. I really hate spiders.
Anybody else got a fear? All right, Aaron.
Okay guys, I have Jared. He is a local. He has a fun question for everyone.
Okay, my question is, if any creature in the Wizarding World was real, which one would you want to have as a pet and why?
I mean, spiders are real.
I would like to have Ginny's one, which is a pygmy puff, because who doesn't want a nice little pink fluffy sort of shoulder companion there? That's good.
Good one.
Can I have a hippogriff as a pet? No.
Hey, I got CJ from Cape Coral, Florida. Great question here for the panel.
Hey guys. You guys are such prolific people. I was wondering, do you guys do anything with your fame to create a positive change in the world?
Have you guys used your fame in any way to create a positive change in the world? Or like...
Or if you had the chance, what would you do?
Yeah, or if you had the chance, what would you do? Do you like volunteer or...?
Yeah, I mean obviously the fact that we have a voice to even sit right here and you guys are listening is an incredible, weird, bizarre feeling.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I mean in my own time and passion, I do work with different organizations from Oxfam to Global Poverty Project and truly believe that we're a generation that should see the end of the eradication of poverty, and I believe it shouldn't really be a word that should be in any sentence. And I think that's what's been so amazing from this experience is that actually we have a platform and a voice to speak on with so many people, and I think Joe's stories are very much in that idea that we each have our voice and we each have our story that's as important as any other student at school or anything. And the fact that we're in an ensemble cast meant that like there was always someone that you could like as an audience member. So yeah, I'm very fortunate and feel that, I don't necessarily feel it's a right that I have to use that opportunity to speak up, but it's just something that I've chosen to do. Yeah,
I think with anyone sort of in the public eye that has an opportunity, as Bonnie says, I think we all feel a certain degree of responsibility that we can, you know, that we can use that voice. I think we all, you know, do our individual charity things. Personally, I got a couple. I've got the Leeds Rhinos Foundation is one that aims to like change children's lives through sport and getting kids active and getting them out and about and teaching leadership skills. And I'm an ambassador for Help for Heroes, which is a UK charity for the armed forces, for our servicemen and women.
Matt, you ever thought about using that to eradicate spiders?
Yeah, I mean, I hate spiders, but I wouldn't want to kill any of them. I'm quite charitable in that sense.
There you go, see? Did you get your friend to do it? Ivana?
I just always think, this isn't necessarily charity work, but I always think it's important for people in high-profile positions to just be honest. I think that, like, so many people, like, there is a sense of separation and people think, oh, you have it all figured out. And I think, I find it, like, even being around these guys and getting to know them, it's always inspired me the way they let themselves be vulnerable and talk about things that afflict them that you're like, oh, I get it too, you know? So just like being honest and open. And then my personal cause is I'm an animal rights activist, and yeah, I really love doing that stuff. And I went vegan last year. Thanks, oh, some vegans here. It's just something I've got so much, I've learned so much from animals, and I don't think it's right that we use them and abuse them unnecessarily. And I just think the more kind of equality and compassion we have for other species, the better we are. I've certainly found, because I think I started it doing, I'm going to do some good in the world, and it inspired me more and it made me feel more centered. I find I'm learning as much from it as whatever I'm doing for it. So.
Supporter of this organization called the Act for Change Project, which was based in the UK, and they've just become a registered charity, which is amazing. And they support diversity within the arts, which I think is lacking on our television screens, on stage at the moment. And I hope to be a representative of those. Of a truer reflection of our society, and hopefully that'll change, with time. Yeah.
That's great. Rusty.
I have Jonelle, and she is from faraway Florida, with a question for you guys.
Hey, first I just wanted to say, hey Matt.
Hi.
this question is for everyone.
Besides your own character, who would you play and why?
And we get this question quite a lot, and we tend to change our answer every time.
Yeah. Felt quite uncomfortable with our last answer. Don't know if anyone heard that. I think I said I wanted to be a Hermione so I could kiss myself. Which I do regret. I want to retract that.
I said I wanted to be Hermione so I could kiss Rupert Grint. which I do regret, and I want to retract that.
That actually does hurt.
It just wasn't as good as I thought it was going to be, that's all. I haven't kissed him.
I'm changing it again because we've been asked this question so many times. We've probably been through every character. I'd like to be a centaur. I like them. Except, oh wait, no, there's no ladies. I'd be the first lady centaur. Yeah. Mix things up, cause some drama in the Forbidden Forest.
I don't have an idea, but also just saying that every single person who's dressed up or worn any type of costume today, like hats off to you guys, because
You all look great. And people who've made their own costumes, that's like super, that's, yeah, hats off.
All right, Julia.
Yes, I have Krista with me from North Carolina with a question for Bonnie.
Bonnie, how did the whole Weasley family feel when they realized that Ginny was the most powerful Weasley wizard?
Wow.
Oh, well, I don't think I'd be as powerful if I didn't have them. So I would say, it was pretty fun being like the youngest Weasley and all, with all my older brothers. I think all the Burrow scenes that we had were to me the fondest memories, just in the sense that those scenes really represented family. You know, Harry didn't have a family, so it was really enjoyable to represent that in the film. I don't think is Ginny the most powerful Weasley?
No.
Well, maybe you have a little battle, no. I don't know, I mean, we were strong as a team, no?
Yeah.
I think
that's
like,
we'll settle that.
Second comment for Bonnie.
Arm wrestle, WWE.
Bonnie, you are the most powerful because none of you guys would have got out of the ministry without your Reducto curse.
This is true. Which is the best, my favorite spell is Reducto. I mean, who doesn't want to destroy anything with a single spell? Well, yeah, okay, I'll take that then. I'll be the strongest.
It's settled.
Go, Ginny.
All right, Aaron.
Okay, guys, I have Tiffany over here. She is from Orlando, Florida, with a question for the panel.
Hi, I'm sorry. All right, so first of all, I love you guys, mainly Rupert, but you know, whatever. But my question is, if you guys weren't famous actors, what would your chosen profession be?
If you could an actor, what would you do?
Well, yeah. I'd be an ice cream man, yeah.
You've already got the truck.
I've got the truck, yeah. I'm all ready to start.
It's done.
What's that?
Come to Wales.
Wales? Nice. Yeah, I can come to Wales, yeah, definitely. What's that? Oh, Brazil. Okay, yeah. I'll do a world tour in the ice cream world.
Rupert Grint's ice cream world tour. Do that.
Yeah.
Can we come as like sort of roadies or groupies or anything?
Yes. Yeah. No, I need all the help. Yeah.
I'll put a couch in there or something, and a TV, and then an ice cream to make sure you can travel in style, especially if you're going all the way to Brazil.
Yeah.
Anybody else? Thank you. Just be awesome, I like it. All right, Brian.
Hey, I've got Riley back here, way back in the cheap seats, all the way from Orlando, Florida. She's got a question for the entire panel here.
Hello. So Universal has Hogsmeade and Diagon already. If you could bring one more magical place, what would it be?
That question was, if you guys could bring one more place from the magical world to life here at Universal Studios, what would it be?
I'd like the Forbidden Forest. There's just so much about that that I feel that we never got to covered in the books or the films. I imagine there could be so much they could do there. And I'd like to get lost in the Forbidden Forest. It would be pretty cool.
I can't choose. I had like 100 in a split second in my mind. I would say, probably said enough about the Weasley family, so I know that we've won the Burrows, but I think like the Triwizard Tournament would be pretty cool to have. I mean, each of us, like you know, you play a part and you play the game yourself. That'd be pretty cool. Yeah.
I agree. I think it would be cool to do the underwater challenge and see the mer people and rescue Katie. Go rescue Joe. because the merpeople were so weird, and I think underwater just has a magical charm of its own, even without all the stuff, and it's so quiet and eerie. And I also can't swim, so I'd like to be on a ride that just pretends I can swim and be a mermaid. That'd be a good one.
I wish we had a Quidditch pitch. That would be really great. Yeah.
All of those things could happen, you never know. Rusty, we got time for a couple more questions.
Okay, I have Kenya here, and she's all the way from Puerto Rico. And brought quite a few family members with her, I see. She has a question as well.
Hi, I'm Kenya. First of all, you guys were my whole inspiration for studying film. And I'm gonna graduate in July, thanks to you guys. And,
congratulations.
My question is for Rupert. Have you gone to the Rent by Rocket?
Yes, I have. Yes. I did it 2 days ago. Well, the music wasn't working though, so I did it in silence.
Oh, okay.
It's quite strange.
Because you did it in silence, will you go with me?
Yes.
Oh my God.
Definitely.
Maybe if it's not working, you can just rap yourself, like...
Just provide the soundtrack.
Is it that time? Is it time for the rap?
Almost, almost. Julia.
Yes, I have Theo with me with a great question.
Hi, hey guys. I love all of you. You all inspired me since my childhood, especially becoming an actor. Filmmaker. I guess my question is, oh, hey there, I'm on TV. Cool. What's next in your careers? Like, what do you guys want to do with your life, like, acting or not acting or whatever? Especially Rupert. I want to say hi to Rupert.
Hey, how you doing?
Cool. Hey.
What's next for you guys?
Well, I've got a film out at the moment called Moonwalkers. About the moon landing conspiracy theory. So yeah, go and see that. There's a few other things kind of on the horizon, but it's just really fun to do new things now, and I really enjoyed doing a bit of theatre as well. That was great. Something I always wanted to do, and it's really nice to make these choices and do new things. It's great fun.
Since I went to film school, I studied directing and writing, and since then I've been making and directing my own films, which has been a really interesting experience. And just how, you know, obviously incredibly informative the experience was as an actress in Harry Potter films and other films, it has been. I just finished directing my third short film last week. Called Medusa's Ankles. That was like the biggest production I've ever done. I was my cast and crew of 40 people on a set that we built, and it was just mind-blowing to the fact that I'd created it. And there's also the lead actor is actually an actor you've seen in Harry Potter before, so watch out for that one.
I'm in the middle of doing a couple of TV shows. I'm playing a Victorian policeman in East London, in Ripper Street. I got a crime drama coming out called Happy Valley, which will be on Netflix at some point this year. And then a film out in summer called Me Before You, which is based on the book by Jojo Moyes. And that's... Yeah, it's a beautiful story, so I really hope you enjoy that one. That'll be out in June.
I'm doing a film at the moment, which I'm not allowed to talk about, which is a shame, but I play a 15-year-old, so that'll be really interesting. But it's taken me, you know, such a long time to decide that acting's what I want to do and stick at. I recently graduated from drama school, and I'm glad I went through the training. So for all of you out there who don't know what you want to do yet, it's fine, it's never too late. Just keep following your dreams and you will get there.
I'm still acting. I have a project coming out this summer, but I find, I recently had like a sort of revelation. I was like, I think I started with my favorite thing in the world, and it's really hard to find anything that I like as much, and I'm probably not as good when I don't like the things as much. So I started to just write, because I'd rather write stuff I like and wait for better things to come along. So yeah, just trying to write and act at the moment.
Aaron.
Over here.
House right. Okay, I didn't think we'd have time. This is awesome. I have Elliot here, and I have Elliot's sister. Now, first of all, Elliot has two comments that she would like to make. One of them is to Ivana, and one of them is to Rupert. So, Elliot, can you tell Ivana what you want to say to her?
I'm so nervous. Okay. Ivana, I've been you twice for Halloween.
Yay!
So, oh, cool. Thank you. I'm flattered.
Now, what did you want to say to Rupert?
I can see why in the movie you're afraid of Aragorn.
Yes. Yeah, spiders. I hate spiders.
Now, Elliot's sister. I'm sorry, I didn't get your name. What's your name?
Miette.
What is your question?
Out of all the films from Harry Potter, which one was your favorite?
I think they change all the time according to sort of the mood I'm in or what I'm liking. I guess for me, the Chamber of Secrets will always hold a really important part for Ginny, and I just loved all of the Tom Riddle's diary and the idea that Voldemort really came into the forefront of that story. I also really, really loved working with Christopher Columbus, who I often feel is forgotten for the work that he really put into Harry Potter. I think he really established that family in those first two films, and if it weren't for him, I don't think the strength of these characters would have kept to be developed and evolved. So for me, it would be the Chamber of Secrets.
All right, we have time for one more question. Brian, what do you got?
Hey, I've got Bryce from Virginia, and she has a great question for Ivana.
I wanted to know what job you think Luna would have in a couple years after Hogwarts.
Well, actually, J.K. Rowling has cleared this up. She becomes a naturalist, or a magizoologist, as I was told today, she studies magical creatures, and she marries Newt Scamander's grandson. But I also kind of think she would have... I think she would have toured the world. She wouldn't be one to settle down early. And I imagine she kind of started a cult, like a sort of weird religious cult, and they would pray to the Crumblehorn Snorkack and believe in things that you're not sure exist, which, I mean, a lot of religions do that, you know? So she, I think she would, yeah, she would encourage people to be free like that in her cult. And then I think she would get tired of it, and she would leave and abandon them and be a mystery. And and then she had twin boys, and she lived out her life hunting crazy animals.
Okay. I need a beat. Oh no. I really can't remember the rap. I can remember one line.
Give me one line.
Yeah.
Nailed it. That was perfect.
That was a good beat, though.
I love it. Thank you. That was for you. I like the yeah. That was perfect. Guys, that is all the time
we
have.
That was a good
rap. I'm sorry. Give it up for our panel! Coming out here for you guys. Thank you so much. We love everything you guys do. We appreciate it. And for you guys, thank you so much for joining us for another successful celebration of Harry Potter 2016. We hope to see you guys next year. Who's coming back? On behalf of myself, Austin, Scotty, me, we'd like to thank you guys for coming out. Hope to see you next year. See you later. Have a good night, guys.